So we had about 350 million migrants in the world, international migrants, which correspond only to 3.4% of the world's population. So it's sizable, but this kind of fear that migrants in the world over is largely exaggerated at the global scale. And about 57% live in the global north. That's how UN defines more developed regions. And 43% live in the global south. For example, Western Asia counts as global south in the UN declaration. And what people think is people going from south to north, from a less developed to a more developed country. But these flows only account for about 35% of the global stock of migrants. So about a third, of global migrants are born in the global south and now live in the global north. If you look at the other direction, people born in the global north and then move to the south, then only 5% of the global. Right? But that includes diaspora returns, so people that are born abroad, Indians, NRIs, and born abroad, ABCDs as we know in America, right? American born confused species, then move back to India, then counted here. But also, when I was living in India for 4 years, I would have been counted here if the census had measured me. And the most important migration flow or corridor is between countries in the global south. So 38% more than most migration, they were born in the global south, and they now live in the global south too. So and as of like 5 years ago, south-south migration has officially overtaken south-north migration. It's important to know because many people, especially in the US and in Europe, think that everybody from the poor countries want to go to the richer countries of Europe, and that's not exactly what the data tells us. And then, of course, important to know of cross migration. Again, almost a quarter of all migrants are born in the global north and they live in the global north in different country within Europe, Canada, the US, Canada, Europe, Europe, Australia, etc. You're not supposed to look at this in detail. This is just how the different people come and where they go in the different countries. So this just tells us that migration is truly multidirectional and is really global. So you can't say that everybody's going to the same country, but we have global flows of migration, which means we need global mobility mechanisms, not just national laws in one country, US, Canada, or India, to take care of this. And this is the latest estimates for Indian immigrants. And we have many diaspora scholars in the room. This, of course, is only NRIs, as counted by census data in countries of destination. Right? So there's a lot of flaws about the data. That's the official UN data. You can see in the last 27 years, the large increase of NRIs, both in less developed countries, the yellow part below, as well as in more developed countries here on the top. These are like millions. And these are the top 15 destination countries, host countries for Indian diaspora. So all the ones in the Gulf region I have highlighted green. Right? It's UAE. UAE has about 3.3 billion, according to census data, which are flawed, we all know that. USA has about 2.3 million. Only people born in India, not second, third, fourth generation. As you may know, the US right now, we count about 3 million, according to the American Community Survey, we look at ancestry and ancestry. Interestingly, these 15 countries together, that's the red line here, is cumulative, together, accounting for 94% of all Indian immigrants. UAE has about 15% alone of all registered, recorded Indian immigrants, and all these 15 countries make most of Indian immigrants abroad. And 54% of Western Asia, and I'm highlighting this because we talk later about human rights and safeguards for migrants. The Western Asia part is the most challenging one in terms of implementation of working conditions. So why should we focus on human rights? Right? We should critically say yes as a student, we all like human rights, but why as adults should we actually pay attention to these things. Here are a few things that I think we should take into consideration. To unpack governance and human mobility, we have to understand different levels of how agencies of migrant effects and countries and economies and societies, and how these in turn have an impact on the migrants' lives and migrants' abilities, etc. I think it's important to uphold migrants' rights because, first, from a moral and normative perspective, it's the right thing to do. If you're a political philosopher, if you look at rights-based approaches, well, upholding rights is important. Those people who do not want to give rights, they're probably not buying into this argument because it's a very hard tool. But I think it's an important starting point for us who work on these issues. Second one, often rights are law. They are international legal standards. And as I will say more about the second part of our discussion today, even this convention that you have read or will read is not all invented. It's based on existing human rights law. It brings together a lot of norms. And so often these are the right not to be tortured or the safety of a person. These are already part of not only the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, but the covenants and many other human rights treaties. The third one is, sometimes there can be naming and shaming in international forum. So if I have a bad track record and I think of myself as a more or less little country, then that can have negative repercussions on the international arena. And now come the arguments that are, from a human rights perspective, maybe the least important, but from a convincing countries, I think the most important ones, which are public policy arguments. And I work at public policy school, I work with governments in the public policy level. And first, increased protection and agency of migrants. Migrants do not have good working conditions. Migrants do not have poor health. Migrants who don't have good living conditions are not very productive members of society. They're much more productive and much better in what they do, contribute if they're healthy, if they're have good conditions. And considering human rights actually leads to better and more appropriate policies. And it creates trust. Many governments actually need trust for the local population, includes migrants, to reach their goals. And lastly, not doing that, not giving migrants the right to go to the police and ask for social justice, not going to the hospital and being treated, may actually pose challenges for public health, because migrants live here. If they have a disease, and if that disease spreads because they can't go to the hospital, it's bad for everybody, because these diseases don't ask for migration status. Same for justice. If they can't go and claim that they're being sexually assaulted, they're being assaulted in other ways, there are other people who do bad stuff out there who are not persecuted, prosecuted, and because I have this lacuna in our system. So these are public policy reasons. And it's important to understand that when we look at the global flow of people and how we look at policies and norms and mechanisms to handle and govern them, and we need to have an approach that includes countries of origin, countries of destination, as well as countries of transit. So the more, and that's the convention actually, I think in Article 1 or 2, we say that actually the different climate migration cycle is part of the approach of the convention. These are a few key migration conventions that already exist. These two here are the 1951 Refugee Convention and the 67 Protocol. It's very, very high ratification, so countries are very much bound by those. And these are the two trafficking protocols. Human trafficking, again, very steep, very high, because of security arguments, and people like the security arguments. The other migration-related treaties we have, especially the green one here, which is the Migrant Worker Convention of 1990, which in the migration and human rights field is the most important one, has very few ratifications. So this graph is not the most up to date. Now we have 51 ratifications. In the next slide, but it's very low level of ratifications. So we have a huge gap actually there, not in terms of ideas, but in terms of ethical human rights norms for global mobility. See now all the countries that have ratified the Migrant Worker Convention, all the orange parts you can see have done nothing. All the dark blue parts here, these are the actions that count ratified the convention. So you can see South America, some countries, Western Africa, some countries. Southwest Africa, Southeast Africa, a few countries, and the Pacific, a few countries, but no major immigration country. These are the kind of all 51 countries right now, I verified yesterday, that have ratified the convention. And they have an average of less than 3% immigrants per population. So, yes, it's important to have them, but in terms of action, family in 2016, the UN General Assembly adopted the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development with 17 goals. And these are the development agenda that now is not only applicable to developing countries, but to the entire world, even the US, even Germany, even France, even Australia. They all have to report on the progress according to these 17 goals, which all have targets, which all have indicators. Migration is important for sustainable development, as the sense for sustainable development, because migration itself can be development. And I know that Professor Rajan has worked on that a lot from Kerala, the international migration reports that the center has published a lot of good data on this. Migration itself is development. Migration can contribute to development. Again, the way others in this room have worked on remittances, on diaspora contributions to development. Sometimes migrants are violent populations. Again, that's what the social work often deals with. Migrants, refugees are violent populations who have to be targeted with special development efforts. And then often we look at sustainable development affecting emigration. In migration, but mostly emigration, we can say, well, if there is a lack of development, people are more prone to leave the country, which is a very oversimplification. And the SDGs, sustainable development goals, have direct targets that are important for all of these areas, as well as indirect targets. We look at poverty, we look at social as a source for social protection, we look at healthcare, we look at education. All of these are important for migration. So the SDG agenda, and that's what I'm working on an everyday basis, actually, it's one of my areas of work, are relevant for migration and human development. Most important are two goals and targets within the goals. In target 10, which is on reducing inequalities among and within countries, we have target 10.7, which says that countries should facilitate orderly, safe, and regular migration, including through well-managed migration policies. That is an official UN document that is all this should be there. We took a lot, many years to actually lobby to get this into the agenda. And the second one is in the target 8.8, in the goal 8 on jobs and economic growth, which says protect labor standards of migrant workers, in particular for women migrant workers. And the last thing that I want to mention here before we get into the convention is that in September, a year and a half ago, the UN adopted another very important framework, the UN Declaration for Migrants, for Refugees and Migrants. And that is an amazing document that has a lot of good language about acknowledging the importance of human rights, of migration governance, of migrants to development, and it sets out the roadmap for two global compacts that right now, as we speak, this week, we have another second round of negotiations that went in New York, discussing the zero draft of the global compact for refugees and the zero draft of the global compact for safe, orderly, and regular migration. These things have already taken in elements from our convention. Our convention already had an impact on influencing this discussion, and we hope that in the future they will have even more. So now, as promised, let's talk a little bit about the reason you actually came here to learn more and discuss more about the model of international convention. More full title is the International Convention on the Rights and Duties of All Persons Moving from One State to Another and the States they need to transfer or enter. You don't have to quote that again, let's protest. There are many different kind of provisions. On the one hand, you have very classic, concrete rights for international mobile populations. Classic human rights, and they have a right to the freedom of, etc. Then you have several obligations of states that don't correspond to enforceable self-executing rights. States should enable people to do that, but it's not really there as a formulated right. Then it must have some rights of states. For example, it reinforces that states have the right to determine who enters a country or not. And can have a philosophical discussion whether states do have that right philosophically, but as a matter of international law, they do have it, and that the convention reaffirms that. And importantly, it has also several provisions that are more guidance, more like a governance framework. It says you can do it that way, you should establish mechanisms like this. So not really a rights-based approach, but it takes some viable multinational framework and other frameworks in terms of getting ideas and giving states a toolbox on hand and what to do about national development. And the last one is to establish institutions on international cooperation. are for the monitoring and of this convention, the rights and the activities that are covered by the convention. Let's talk about rights. That's the core piece of this, is about rights. The key idea is that there are many different people that become mobile population mobility. Mobility is more than migration. And as demographers, we have at least one demographer in the room, we can have a long discussion how to measure migration. The UN Population Commission has guidance, at least one here, born abroad. But we of course know that is a refugee a migrant? And the demographers may say yes, the policy and the leader may say no. So there are many different terms and definitions out there. There's not one single definition. So we have several definitions of different populations, starting with the most basic, which is the visitor. Visitors is anybody. Right now, here, I'm a visitor. I'm not really a tourist. I'm not a student. The basic thing is I just came here. I'm here, physically here. And already by being here, I have rights. The migrant work convention, the convention will not apply to me because I'm not working here. Or, well, maybe you could say I'm working, but probably I'm not. And visitors have, of course, the smallest spaces for having rights. So if you want this, there's one seat for them up there. If you want this, there's one. So visitors have some rights. Each additional category that we come up from the left right now has the same rights as the previous one, but some more. So they're cumulative. Huh? So there's a little bit, and then the next one has a little bit more, the next one has a little bit more. That's the structure of our convention. But tourists have a few more rights than visitors, and they have also obligations that I say in the moment. Then there's students, and I forgot, of course, the student migration. But so students, and of course, important international mobile populations who are often not covered by conventions on migration. And then we have the body of migrant workers and migrant residents. Migrant workers are all those who are abroad and actually engaged in remunerated activities. One concept we came up with in this view is migrant residents. Of course, the migrant worker idea is that you are somewhere regularly or irregularly, and just because you work, you have rights. You could say that's a capitalist idea, you know, you have to keep working to get rights. If you're just a human being, you don't have rights. So if you're a migrant resident, which means you have to be for at least 1 year, so it needs to be time in a certain country, you have the same rights as a migrant worker. Right? So that's what our way of getting around this capitalist critique of migrant worker, but still it's based on the migrant worker. And it's bigger because there's several subcategories. One is migrant workers and families in an irregular, undocumented situation. Or as we call them in India, infiltrators. Yeah? Then there are migrant workers in a regular situation who have more rights, or considered more rights than those in the irregular situation. Then you have migrant entrepreneurs with a special category for entrepreneurs. More and more countries actually give certain concessions for people who come to invest money, so we want to cover those too. And of course, we have temporary migrant workers and migrant domestic workers. And I'll talk more about all of these in the end of this presentation. And the last category are forced migrant refugees. Forced migrant refugees have two different regimes. The first regime are international refuge, which corresponds to international migrant refugee status. And then there is a little minus status, a little less, which is interim protection, which corresponds to subsidy protection or temporary protective status, so people who get a little less than full refugee status. I don't know if you had a chance to look at this graph, which I think was part, and if you look at the summary of things that the center shared with you in preparation of today's workshop, it looks very pretty, right? But it looks a little scary, a little complicated. But the idea that I just presented in the previous slide is, and can be encapsulated in this graph, where you have different categories of people, visitors, tourists, students, etc., who go from here to here, and these are different rights that people can have. You can see in the beginning, visitors have their gaps in there, they don't have rights for some things. Whereas the next last category, which is refugee migrants and forced migrants, have almost all the rights. So different categories of people have different sets of rights. That's the innovation that we in a comprehensive exercise, we try to think what is doable, what is not doable. One thing I should also say about this. committee that I will talk more about later. Sometimes tourism can be a bane. For example, we also have a provision of tax tourism. Just think that any kind of national mobility can be good is false. There are some parts that are bad, and we have to be named them in there too, that need to be discouraged. Let's talk briefly about refugees and forced migrants, which is not the focus of today's discussion, because India has fewer issues with these, but of course they are growing, as some of you know, and with like Rohingyas coming in, with other minorities being Afghans, and of course Sri Lankans and Iraqis, etc. One issue, so we have a very good instrument, we have the 1951 Convention. Right? The 1951 Convention, supplemented by the 67 Protocol, which is a very important instrument. There are a few shortcomings, and we're not trying to reinvent all of that, but a few shortcomings of the 51 Convention that this is trying to address. So we take the 51 Convention as a basis. We say, well, of course, that nothing of that can actually preclude rights from the Convention, so whatever you have rights from the Convention will not be diminished. But one shortcoming of the Convention is the narrow definition of refugee. Under the 1951 Convention on Refugees, refugees are someone who is individually persecuted. And that's what the idea of a communist dissident in Russia, right? Who was against Russia, he or she was targeted, and then he or she fled. But the war refugees, etc., they're not really well covered under the Convention. So we included them, incorporating language from the OAU, the Organization of African Unions, the predecessor of the AU, 67 Convention on Refugees, the Cartagena Declaration in Latin America, as well as other legal instruments. So we say forced migrant is everybody who has a serious or is facing a serious threat to life, physical integrity, or freedom, resulting from generalized violence or against seriously disturbing public order. So if there's a war, civil war, etc., this is a serious thing. You don't have to be individually persecuted. And also everybody who is suffering serious harm to compel to leave because of a state of origin. Or if somebody would be returned and then face a real risk of suffering serious harm. That's both related to the non-refoulement, Article 33 of the UN Convention, as well as the US has a status called SIE, which is a special refugee status, which this is based on. So this is forced migrant. And then we have, takes the Refugee Convention's definition for refugee, tweak a little bit more gender neutral language because it says yes, etc. So we eliminate those and add a few clarifications, but overall keep the refugee convention's definition for refugee as it is in 126A1A is also. Content wise, there are a few innovations or things that we try to address shortcomings of the convention. First is the Refugee Convention has a lot of rights, a lot of good catalog of rights, but most of the rights, where it says, has the right to secondary education, same as aliens, other foreigners, not the same as nationals, same as for employment, etc. So in our suggested convention, we give migrants, forced migrants and refugees the same rights as nationals, with regard to both employment, public housing, etc. And as I mentioned a couple of slides ago, there is interim protection versus international refuge. International refuge is the full status, but in some cases, countries can have what now the European calls subsidiary protection, what the US calls temporary protective status. A lot of people coming in can't have individual assessment, you just give a group prima facie and descriptive status to these people. And this is allowed in a convention with fewer rights, but only for a limited amount of time, and also only in the case of mass influx. Right? So it's there. States need sometimes this kind of tool, but it needs to be limited. And if they don't remedy the situation in a period of time, they have to get a real full refugee status. Okay. A few slides on institutions and mechanisms. Having a convention, having a body of norms is good. But all of us work in real life, not just on legal text, say, who is going to do about it? What kind of changes will this make in the lives of migrants in Qatar, in Bahrain, in the US, in France, in Bangladesh? So one question that every convention, every legal text has to ask about enforcement, about European Convention on Human Rights has a core of being. European Court of Human Rights, the best instruments which execute judgments about violations of human rights, etc. But there's not many countries who want to have the courts that politically be sensitive issues, especially global. So what we decided at the treaty body is having a committee. And that's modeled after the Migrant Worker Convention, which also has a committee based in Geneva. Initially, the committee would be 10 experts voted on by the member states. The member states are, of course, in charge here, and they can each as a member. Once there are more than 41 ratifications, we have 14 members of the committee. And the committee has several duties. The first one is every country has to report every 5 years about changes, about commitments, what did they do, what can they achieve. So then the committee comments on those reports, and you have and civil society can comment, but it's a daily shaming, it's like, oh, you didn't do that. It's not the most important mechanism to actually get things done, but it's a more realistic process than having a committee that goes in on its own account and judges, right? So that's the first procedure. The second one is a dispute resolution mechanism. And there are two mechanisms mentioned in our convention. The first one is a state-to-state mechanism. So one state, Pakistan, can say, you Bangladesh violated, or India can say, Saudi Arabia, you mistreated our Indians, Indian migrants, you didn't even exercise your rights under the convention. I want this to be pronounced by the committee. The second one is individual communication. So me as a migrant, being in India, a German migrant in India, I can go and say, India violated my rights as a visitor by not giving me health care. Emergency health care. Both of them are not compulsory. Because states would not be very likely to ratify and accede to this treaty if it ever were to be adopted, if we had these compulsory, right? So states can opt in, opt out of these things. We hope that some countries will opt in, but that's the most dicey issue of most countries to have an organ that says, yes, I will pronounce you right or wrong, right? But that's an important mechanism. And there are several other international cooperation mechanisms that the convention foresees. But from the committee, we have some for international protection and one for labor migration. For labor migration, there will be an exhibition to have visa mobility clearing house, where it's a platform where all countries are supposed to upload their visa demand. They say, oh, we need temporary migrants for engineers. We need that many in construction. For the Olympics, we need as many. So they can all upload the data, and then individuals, states, companies can all access the data and have the matching between migrants and jobs and visas. That's the idea of visa mobility clearinghouse. Then there is a permitted subcommittee, which the idea is that it looks at the cost of remittances. Of course, India being the world champion of remittances, absolutely speaking, at least, right? That's important to reduce the cost, which is also part of the Sustainable Development Goals. Target 10.C aims at reducing the cost below 5%, below 3%. For international protection, there's the idea to have a fund for refugees, a refugee fund, money for durable solutions, for refugee settlement, for things for refugees. We have a comprehensive global planning platform where units are the IOM, governments, the World Bank can come together and plan durable solutions, return measures, etc. for refugees. And the last one, the most important one, is responsibility sharing, where even right now the Global Compact for Refugees has the idea of establishing some kind of mechanism where countries say how many refugees they should take in. As you may know, of the global stock of refugees, 4% are in the global south and 60% are in the global north. That means all of Europe, all of Northern America, Canada, US, all of Australia and New Zealand combined have 16% of the global refugees. So the idea of a global refugee crisis, where Germany takes 1 million migrants or refugees, that's a lot compared to last year, but it's not a lot in terms of global averages, right? And so the idea is how to calculate how many refugees the country should resettle or get. And we have a model there we adopt from the population size, how many refugees in total in four, etc., are all combined into one measure of mobility of first people shares. And then we just start with the score here, we actually say yes, we did well, we didn't do well. So the measure or the enforcement would be through naming and shaming, but there is an actual number of how much you can how much you're supposed to take. And sometimes you can say, well, I pay money instead of getting people. Or you can say, I'm getting people instead of paying money. But in the convention that we spell it out is, you cannot only give money. So like the Gulf countries, they don't want to have any refugees. But they only, so that's not possible. But you can also not say, I'm only taking people without giving money. So you have to be a mix of responsibility taking in people and paying for them. Last part is about actually migrant workers, which I think is of most of importance for what most of you are working on and under the World Convention. As I said earlier, we have three categories of people that I'm highlighting. The first are migrant workers in an irregular situation. The second one are migrant workers in a regular situation. And in between are temporary migrant workers who have in between rights. What I only mentioned in passing is there are other categories that I don't go into detail right now, such as entrepreneur migrant, migrant domestic workers, migrant seasonal workers, migrant project specific workers, and then we have also frontier workers and then really small like employees from companies. So all we think of mobility since well, there's one area that doesn't really fit neatly into these categories, so we can get a little broader canvas of these categories. And looking at the first category, the most broadest in the migrant worker is those for undocumented migrant workers, which again, cumulative rights is also applicable to all the subsequent categories. So undocumented and all, for example, have the right to emergency health care and to health care where public health requires immunization, diseases, etc. Again, that's in the interest of the states to for the health of their own populations, unless they have them in a safe zone, right? So that's an easy sell normally for the states. It's in your own interest, not just human rights based. It's also human rights based, of course. And the second, and that's really important, ILO has said that for many, many years, the International Labour Organization, where people work, they're not migrants, they're not natives, they're workers. If I work in a factory, if I work in a construction place, if I work at home somewhere, I need to have the same working conditions, the same conditions of my labor as a native. A worker is a worker. That's an idea that the ILO for like now 120 years has been pushing. And many countries have not heard that. They have much worse working conditions, much less regulations for migrant workers, especially, of course, for domestic workers, as you all know. The wages we pay to them, again, that's in there, and they have a right to transfer the money home. So remittances are as a right there, anchored to the convention. They have a right to join trade unions, and they have a right to decent living conditions. So the last of you who work on migrants in the Gulf know that living conditions are not always very decent in these cases. And they have the right to primary and secondary education for their children. Their children, according to the CRC, the Convention on the Rights of the Child, people have the right, children have the right to education, right? And regardless of their immigration status, their children need education. If they don't get education, it's bad for them, and it's bad for society because they would be growing up adults. And they have, again, that's important for our diaspora researchers, they have a right to vote in the country of origin. So we have not just in the immigration country, but a right in the country of origin. If you work abroad, you have a right to work, to vote in the country of origin. It's also problematic in some countries. In North India, until the change of the election act, there was a big question whether Indians and Irish could ever vote. And then now you can kind of vote. They can. Those who are in a regular situation, documented migrants in Burma, have even more rights. They have right to temporary absence. It's very important if you to return to your origin. Right? Just take care of your family. Try to have a business. For a month or 2 months away. It's important to have that right without forfeiting your immigration status, without forfeiting your right to have the citizenship later on. And have freedom of movement in the country. You have the path, the right, you have the path to permanent residency and citizenship. And equal In the Migrant Worker Convention, there are a lot of different rights to temporary workers. And people find that a lot of destination countries, Europe, America, etc., are reluctant to ratify this convention, among other, because they feel that temporary workers get too many rights, and they don't want to give these rights to these temporary workers. So we all know rights versus numbers. You know, you want to have some temporary workers, you want to have them give rights, but if you have too many rights, then another bit then. So that's the challenge we have in this one. So we say there's few things you can limit the rights of temporary workers. For example, you can limit the right of free movement in the country. You can limit the access to social security and employment benefits. And there are certain other limits you can have for temporary migrants. But then you have definitely multi-entry visa, so they can't go back and forth. They get poor pensions. They get poor pensions, a huge critical thing for migrants in the world. And most importantly, I think that's the most innovative thing that this convention does, is there are 10 years of temporary status. As you know, in the Gulf region, many Indians are temporary for 20 years, or 30 or 40 years. They're not temporary in an actual thing. They're just temporary in terms of their limitation of their immigration status. Sometimes a year, and a half year, 10 years, etc. And that is very problematic from human rights point of view, from so we say, well, after 5 years of temporary status, everybody should be given the chance to apply for permanent residence. And after 5 years, everybody needs to be adjusted to permanent residence. So we change temporary immigration status. We always get 3 years more, 3 years more, 3 years more, 3 years more. You never put down roots and everything, oh, we're going to return next year. That should be avoided. And there's more temporary limitations. And after not more than 2 years, you should be able to choose your work. After not more than 6 months, you should be tied to one employer. So the idea that you're employed for 3 months, for 3 years, for 4 years, to one employer, you cannot move. Kafala system, but also in the US, the H1B has for a long time, that should not be the norm for temporary migrants. So these are important, I think, we think in the Commission, very important parts of innovations of formats. The role of collaborative academic endeavors from the MIMC Treaty Commission to the adoption of international convention. And I could probably put that already as a full paper. Yeah. So this is an overview of the convention process. So we started in 2015 with the concept and the first drafting the idea. Then the most part was in 2016 until mid-2017. So we had about a year and a half, almost 2 years of real commission work. We met every couple of months and we were discussing the different parts. It was really organized as chapters were organized. We started with chapter one, then chapter two, then chapter three. So the drafts, 11 of them were just piled one after another. It wasn't just everything in the beginning. We had one session on the first, and the second, and the third chapters, etc. And it was, I forgot exactly the date, but I think it was about August or so last year when we all said this is the final thing, and we signed it. As I mentioned at the beginning, I mentioned it again, the convention is open for signatures from anyone. Anybody can sign it. There's two categories, I'm sorry for the class system here, of academics, professors, and who are like of a public standing already, and who of course lend more weight than just numbers. You know, we want to have some kind of convincing power of states, what kind of people have seen that and think it's a good idea. And then also the general populace, so any student, any family member you have, any migrant can sign this to the general signature. And it's open, and if you don't have the link yet, Tulika will send you the link where you can do that, or email me, I'd be happy to share that with you. Now we're in the launch and promotion phase, so this is also one of the global launches. So we have one of the global launch, it's the only one in Asia so far, I think Singapore is either planned or, yeah, but where we actually launched this in Asia. And then the idea, as you can see, there's a little time gap, 15, 16, 17, 18, 28. That's our like year where we hope maybe at some point states will have adopted this in some form or another. And my last slide of this presentation is about what happens there. this is a slide of a commission, a global equality commission. We can see very strong books. For some reason, that category name, but that this is the United States, I think it's a flag, and which has the largest share of professors. But this is all university, and others are people who are not academics, right? So Europe mostly from the UK, but we've got France and Portugal, and Spain, Australia University, University of Asia. This is second colored because we have one a person from Asia who holds the flag for the continent. Africa, we have two people from South Africa. And then other 13%, we have think tanks from the UN, former UN, and government. In the total, we're about 64 people. And 64 people in a company sounds like a lot, but it's not that all these 64 people work together all the time. So working modalities where we had different sessions. We had funding from the Open Society Foundation, from the Soros Foundation, and we were physically meeting in New York in the building of the Open Society Foundation. But we had also video links to different people. And that's what my question had later for you and my reflections on how can you make an academic commission actually work, which is actually not that easy or much more difficult than you would think, or some of you would think. This is just the launches are, launched it here in India and South Africa, and Sydney, and other parts of the world, and Barcelona, mentioned it. And the blue spots are where commission members are based. It's important to stress the rights under the MIMC were not invented. So it's not just sat together and think, what kind of rights should we have? No, of course, we drew on a lot of different material. So it's more the compilation with an adaption, adaptation than the invention of rights. So these are a few of the sources that we use to draw on. And first, Migrant Work Convention. I thought the Migrant Work Party really drew a lot on the Migrant Work Convention. Omitted some parts, tweaked some parts, but we have to do very heavily on the convention. The UN Refugee Convention and Protocol I mentioned already were, of course, very important to inspire us on the refugee post-migration part. Then we looked at regional regulations and regional treaties from ASEAN, African Union, or OAU before that, and the EU. The EU, for example, has a lot of regulations for refugees, for asylum procedures, etc., which drew on as good standards because there's already legal language, something that has been tried and tested, and there's no scholarship evaluating it. And then we look at jurisprudence by international and national courts and actually look at these different rights and draw conclusions on what is good, what is bad. Then we look at UN recommendations like the ILO. International multilateral framework for better migration and MIGOF, the migration governance framework the IOM adopted 2 years ago, or the policy institutional coherence for migration and development model that I was a part of with the OECD, UNDP, and World Bank. And all these things inspire the convention, right? So often when you read the convention, there are often footnotes in the bottom. They're not exhaustive, but sometimes you say this is drawn on the Migrant Work Convention, this is drawn on a certain so I encourage you to read it, you can see some linkages to some of those arguments. And of course, economic analysis, and the last one is state practice. So sometimes individual states, unilaterals if you like, have adopted something interesting. You said, oh, that's good, we could adopt that as an international global best practice. So these are the main sources of the convention. And so this is the question of questions. How do we make academics work? Because if you just put 64 academics together in a room or in a virtual room, you know, there will be some discussion, but it's very hard to make them work. And that's actually how these things are. There's only a core number of people who actually do the work. And there are a few people who have to do the first drafting. So you always have to have a group of people who first write something, and then you give it to someone and say, you please comment on it. Because people comment, they can comment, but it's very hard for people to actually just start writing, right? That's the first thing. The second is that you have to be a structured approach. Like you have to have an approach where you say, committee, and this time we only discuss this section. And we had, for example, always a couple of people writing the section, and then we had two or three people who were discussants. These people were supposed to give a little talk at the beginning, giving their comments. So you know these three people really read the draft. The others, we have glanced over it, you know, so we all know we are busy, so all the 64 people will really go through each, and provision is not very likely. Some may do it, some may not, so you have to have a few people who actually have the task of providing comments, so that the likelihood is higher for them to actually do it. And then, the fact that you have the people physically there is not just send your comments by a certain deadline, but it is actually to say this day, and people then get a lot of ad hoc comments, right? We all have a lot of experience in migration, management, governance, etc. So once you have prepared your comments, you are the good worker at home, you're in your work, then maybe some other person says, oh, wait a moment, I didn't prepare my comments, but I have ad hoc comments. So a lot of discussion still developed without much preparation by some committee members, but still drawing on the experiences and knowledge of people, right? That's how I think these things just react to people. What also was important that we had some funding from Open Society Foundation, which we didn't need much money, but sometimes we were thrown in a little bit more entities from Canada, people could come from Montreal, or we had these very nice facilities. Very good consumer call facilities, very good feeling. And you could, of course, use just Skype or freeconferencecall.com, but having these nice facilities made the work much easier. What is also important, and really behind most efforts is one person, right? And here, Professor Michael Doyle has been mentioned. He was really the visionary, he kept things moving. He was the person who really engaged all the people. The breakdown of the commission was not that he didn't sit down on the mat and say, okay, I have a representation. No, he called the people he knew, but it wasn't a really thoughtful effort. He himself says that, right? It was inviting the people he knows, and then he goes somewhere and gets somewhere else that doesn't really want to be on that comment. Because it's a more natural way of doing it, and I think that's a lot of how we do our network. We do the networks, we don't go ways about it. But having one person with a clear idea, having clear deadlines, having a clear schedule how to do it, was pretty important. And as I said, having people comment on it, asking us to comment on it. If somebody gives a comment in the session, tell them, please give me language on it. Don't just say, oh, I think you should do something about visas and this. Like, okay, that's a great idea. Draft me something. Because often the devil is in the detail. So it's a good thing to have an idea, but to it down to a right or a guidance and something like that is much more tricky than me included thought at the beginning. So I think that was and I said our goal is to have this adopted at some point, maybe 10 years. Michael also says 10 years, but he like waiting, hopes it will be earlier. He's and Michael, as some of you know, was assistant secretary general at the UN and the Kofi Annan, he wrote centralize the Millennium Development Goals also, and so he has a lot of good connections, high connections with UN, climate, UN, where UNP and well, and OECD, where we try to push it to UN channels. NGOs, of course, are right now and the core target audience, and we really try to get more states involved. The co-facilitators of the open working group on the two drafts, the Global Compact for Refugees, Global Compact for Migrants is taking place right now in New York and Geneva. They have engaged in discussion with them to actually get it to them, and they have already considered some of the proposals in the year. The last slide I have is okay. Prominent endeavor to the action fee. So we have the convention, question with the consultations, and then will there be a treaty? How will this work that all these things end up there? So what did the theory of the So the question is really, what do we even have partnerships to? What kind of alliances do we need with states, with non-governmental partners, with the media, right? With other agencies to get it out there and to get it to a state where states will use some form of this text, go to the drawing board, and then of course change it. Nobody thinks that they just will sign this treaty. states at some point, and we ask the state, well, what do you think? And my question to you is also, what do you think? And what are your experiences with similar processes of academic learning, academic exercises, and their translation into policies, into laws, into treaties? And what do you think should be done in this regard to actually get this into something real and not just an academic endeavor?